Hi, this is MC Shetty for the fifth and last episode of my automation tutorials. So here I will show you the last special features of RFTools Control, and we will start with autocrafting. So you can do autocrafting with RFTools Control. It's not as easy as with Applied Energistics or Refined Storage, but it's fun to do. And it's actually pretty powerful if you know how to set it up, but it's also a bit complicated, so let's see how it works. First, we have this chest with ingredients. Let's clear this, the program is already installed. Let's remove it for now. And then you have a workbench. A workbench is a regular crafting table. For example, if I would have some cobblestone and you would insert it, you would be able to craft it. So you can use it as a regular crafting station with some internal inventory. Looks just like that. In this case, I put crafting cards in the inventory. Let's open one. So these are real recipes, and so that's a recipe for gold nugget, for sticks, crafter tier 1, crafter tier 2, crafter tier 3, redstone torch, crafting table, and machine frame. So these are all the things that you can make with these ingredients, and they will be used to craft. This is the crafting station. It's currently inactive. So you need a network card to access that crafting station. It's using it doesn't show the crafting stations that are connected. Actually, it would be nice if it did. Something I might have to do. So this is the program. How does it work? Basically, we use the event craft, and what does this say? So execute program when a crafting station requests a specific item or for an inventory with crafting cards. This operation sets the crafting ticket. So basically what happens here, we check the inventory with crafting cards, the east side, that's east, so that's this workbench. So that means that this opcode makes all recipes available that are in these crafting cards. This is optional, we don't have a specific item. We use all the items here. So just this event alone, as soon as you insert the program here, the crafting station will know all these objects to craft because they are in this crafting, in this workbench. And as soon as you request an item here, the program will fire and this will start working. And what happens here? The first operation is get ingredients smart. This is a pretty complex operation. It does a lot of things. You can see here that the tooltip is pretty large. So what does it do? It checks if all the ingredients for a crafting operation are available in another inventory. So basically, did we set it up? So this is the inventory for ingredients. So that's up. You can also leave this empty for the storage system. So this is the inventory with all the cards, the crafting cards. That's this one. There's no specific item. we want to fetch all ingredients in the internal process slot from 0 to 8. We do OR dictionary, and that's the inventory where we will place the destination of our request. So intermediate results and will be placed here. We use the same, by the way, usually you use the same. So what does this operation do? Giving this event and the crafting ticket. So the crafting ticket indicates, gives information about what the user selected to craft. So from that, yeah, so the item to craft are empty for default from ticket. So we leave this empty. So we fetch ingredients for the item that we want to craft. This can have a few results. For example, result null on success, that means that all ingredients were successfully fetched. Let's, as a test, insert this. Oh yeah. Okay. Actually, I do need this one. Yeah. Let's just insert the program again. And oh, yeah, okay. So it requested a bunch of things. Well, let's do the test a bit different. Let's just do sticks and remove this one. Sticks like that. So it, this program card is allocated to this, that's for the output. So you see how it fetched these two. And let's cancel the operation and fix a program like that. So that's what this does. So the result of this operation is 0 if it was okay, minus 1 on failure, and so that means that no ingredients are there, and otherwise the number of items that are requested. So if this returns 0, so if it's greater than minus 1, we go to the right, but if it's 0, no, sorry, if it's minus 1, we mark a crafting failure, so that ends this program. If it's greater than 0, then we go here, but if it's 0, then it is okay. That means that we can actually craft, and that means that all the ingredients will be here. So what do we do then? Push items into workbench. So push multiple items from the internal inventory to the workbench. And because it's this knows about crafting, so that's the workbench on the east side. These are the 9 slots. The item will be getting, will be gotten from the ticket again, the craft ticket. So it will transfer these items in the right shape for crafting to this these slots. That's what this one does. You don't have to specify destination slot because it knows how to do that. It knows this is specific for the workbench. It only works with that block. And as soon as this is put here, the crafting slot will be filled, and here we fetch that. So from down, so the east at the workbench, the downside is for the output slot. We put the result here in this slot, and we mark a success. Otherwise, we have a special situation. Here it's more complicated. We know we got some of the ingredients, not all, and that means that there will be a part of the ingredients needed to craft the item. So what can we do here? This operation will also have requested, as if, for example, let's put back the program so you can see. So if you, for example, click this one and there are no sticks yet, so it will fetch the redstone because redstone is present, and it will send a request to craft sticks as if you clicked here on sticks as well. So that's what this one does as well. So what do we do here? We push multiple items, that's this operation, push multiple items from the inventory item to next to the inventory. So we push back to our input chest, 0 to 8, and we don't care about where it will go in the input chest. So basically we clear the grid, because we want to wait for the other crafting events to finish. So basically what do we do here? We wait for finished craft. This ends this program, but it will make sure that this event gets fired later. So let's suspend the crafting operation and resume it at regular time. So every 5 ticks this event will get fired, and it will check if there is a crafting operation to resume, and this is for safety, because it's possible that the request is cancelled before it can be evaluated. So we get the current desired crafting result from the ticket, because this also sets the ticket, and if that's set, then we again try to get the ingredients, which may or may not fail. If that's not set, we stop, we mark a failure. So this is basically the program. So let's try it out. So let's say simple first, make some nuggets. So that was easy, they will go here. Now make some redstone torch. So it had to make sticks, and 3 of those sticks have gone here. So if I do it again, it doesn't have to make sticks again, because it already had sticks. So let's do something more complicated, a crafter tier 3. Voila, here you have it. So it used all kinds of ingredients. It also had to make gold nuggets, which it didn't all use, that's for the machine frame. You can also make multiples, for example, shift click and then 3. That's the first. Okay, that's the third. So that's basically how autocrafting works. Okay, so now this isn't the fastest. What can you do to speed this up? You can't simply insert another crafting core. That wouldn't really work, because the problem is that there is only this area to check, so you can't really run this in parallel easily, because there's a risk that they will both use the same area here. And that can give very weird results. So for example, if you have both processors running two crafting events, one can do this one, starts doing this one, starts working, and then not the other one wants to start to also this one, but at this point there may already be some items here, so it will start to do weird things. So that's not a good idea. One way to solve this would be to use blocks, but I made a program here which shows that. So this is the same program as before, but it sets a lock. That means that before doing anything, before using these slots, it will lock with the name craft, which means only one running program can have a lock. So this operation tests a lock, and if it's available, it will set it and immediately start running. If the lock is not available, this will wait. The program will keep running, but it will be sitting here waiting until the lock becomes free. So then the program that's running, there can be only one program running here until the lock is freed again, which you have to do before ending this program. Unfortunately, that doesn't really help, because by doing that lock, you essentially make sure only one program can do this at the same time, so it will hardly give any speed benefit. So that's not, give me back, so that's not the way to do it. But there is a way. What you can do is use, I forgot the card, is use two crafting cards and allocate them different. So this card has this, is these slots. Assign these slots to this card, like that. Use two cores and set this. So what happens here? Basically, we now have two cores, and we pressed exclusive mode. That means that every card will run on one core. So all programs on this card will only run on this core, and all programs on this card will only run on this core. And both cores use different areas here, so they should not interfere with each other. They can do things just fine. There is, however, a bug where everything appears double, so I have to check that. It's harmless, but it's a bit annoying. But it should wait, and it should be a bit faster now. So that's basically how you can do multiple crafting slots at the same time. Of course, it's limited to two. There's not enough room for three. But you should be able to combine this with, for example, two other programs that do melting-based crafting, because that's also possible. You can make variants of this program that work with furnaces, for example, so to redstone furnace, for example, and then you can also request them from here. So that's one thing that you can do, and so you can, by doing that, you can have four programs on the same machine. Four input output, so two smelting operations and two normal crafting operations. And with some work, you can also make a setup where you have multiple processors doing things. So instead of multiple cores, you use multiple processors. There's a lot more that you can do with crafting. This is a simple program. But yeah, there are some other operations, talentcrafts, and I will probably in the future add some more operations here. Also fix that bug so that you can do more nice things. Also, at some point, I think I want to be able to request this to have more integration with the storage scanner, for example, that you can request from the storage scanner or remotely using some kind of tablet, for example. That would be nice to have, but that's for the future. So one other feature that I want to show you that is not related to crafting is inter-process communication. So I have this simple program. When a redstone signal is received, it will evaluate a string. The string is hello. It will put it in a variable, and it will send a message. The name of the message is message. The slot with the identifier is 0, and the variable is 0. So that's this program. For inter-process communication to work, so this is the program, communicate, and it uses this slot. So this is a special network identifier. It's to set it up, so that's the other machine that I want to use. Sneak right click, and then it will be configured to that. And for programs to use it, you have to put it in a slot there. And you need an advanced network card to use inter-process communication. So what happens now? Okay, so this is the program for sending the message, and on the receiving side we have a simple program that receives the message. So name message, and we print this will set the last value to the parameter that was given, and we print it out. Just this one, nothing else, and a big screen showing the console. Let's try it out. You see, hello was printed there. So that's how you can do inter-process communication. So the process that sets needs the identifier for the destination and an advanced network card, and you can use this token for event message, and this token to send a message. Rather simple. So the variable that you send over in this case, no, it was this one. Which variable did I use? That one. So that's the string. You can send over any kind of variable, even a vector. So you can send a lot of information there. And speaking about information, there's one other thing. This is also some special feature. It's a token. It's really very, very simple. It's just information. So what can it do? I don't have a real example here, but I can show it. So you can, for example, set there, and then you can have a program to get a value from that token or set a value to that token slot, and that would be this slot. And what can you set in a token? Literally any value. Then this token, well, let's just as a test, let's move that, and let's actually, let's do it like this. Token slot 0. Save token let's use this slot. So now we have two programs listening to the redstone event. Yeah. And this, yeah. You see now it contains type string value hello. So this now has information, and then you can do whatever you want with it. You can move that to another machine, for example, to there, using, for example, remote storage from RFTools, and use that information there. So I leave the use cases up to you, but I'm sure there are some possibilities there. Yeah, okay, so I think we covered all of these now. One final thing before finishing. There's this opcode, this parameter that I didn't mention yet. So you already saw the use of this one, which makes sure that every program card is assigned to a fixed CPU core. If you don't use this, programs will run on whatever CPU core is available. And also, for example, if you have an event like that, if you have a long running program here and you click multiple times, yeah, now token is gone, so it gives an error there, but the other program worked. So if you click multiple times, it is possible for this program to run multiple times as well. So the same program can, if there are sufficient cores available, the same program can run multiple times. If you don't want that, if you want to make sure that program can only be run once, even if there are new events while the program is still running, you can set this to true. And that will prevent the program from running multiple times. It will only have one instance on any core at the same time. So that's what this single does. Only one simultaneous run. Okay, and other than that, yeah, there are various opcodes, get name, get damage, lots of things you can do. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention. Yeah, there's also a fluid support. So just put this next to, and you get these extra slots. This is a tank, it can contain four different fluids, but you can't interact with it directly, only it's just meant as an internal internal thing for the RevTools control. So let's put a tank here, you see up, you can have multiple tanks. So you see up four slots, north four slots. So let's make a quick program here. Say on redstone signal again. I believe it was east, yeah. Where is it? Oh, facing west. Yeah, this is the east was there. So what do we do? Let's use that milk that lose a deep resonance tank for this one, and let's put some lava in it. Like that. And that node was called input. So what do we do? Get liquid in tank. Examine liquid. Oh, hold on, how do you transfer liquid again? Oh yeah, those I need to check here, of course. Fetch liquid. fetch liquid from an external tank adjacent to the processor or a connected node. So tank input up, and let's access it from north. Yeah, so that we can set this site to provide amount a bucket. Fluid is optional, just whatever is in, and we put it in slot 0. Let's just do that. Let's get rid of this one. We allocate this liquid slot, it works with allocation as well. And then we have our... Where did it go? Liquid program. Let's see if it works. Yeah. So you see we got lava there, and it also shows in the one probe. But it can't be extracted from this block. This is just internal storage now for the processor. And then you can use whatever other operations to examine it, or push liquid to another tank, and so on. If you work with deep resonance, there are also various opcodes to read the quality of liquids. And then there, by the way, these opcodes for XNET as well, test it, turn on or off an XNET channel. That can be useful if you want to work with XNET channels and you want to be able to disable them. And test if a certain color is enabled. But I ran out of time. I think I covered everything that there is to cover. There are lots of things that you can do with RF2's control. It's really up to your imagination in how to use it and how to combine it. I hope this was useful. And if you have questions, you know where to find me. So, see you next time. Bye bye.